So what is real in quantum mechanics? If you have a quantum state that's a superposition of many possibilities, do you call those possibilities virtual or real? The system could manifest itself in any one of those possibilities. So I would say that makes it real. On the other hand, before it actually manifests itself in one particular way, you may want to call it virtual. Call all the rest of them virtual, let's say. See what I'm saying? There's a language problem, I think.
Uh-huh.
There's a particular connection with quantum mechanics in this thermal nature statement. Let me also emphasize that. The quantum vacuum of fields is a pure quantum state. That means it's a single vector. It's described by a single vector in Hilbert space. The state is definite in the sense of being a single vector in Hilbert space. But the degrees of freedom on different sides of my imaginary wall are entangled with each other. So if I have access only to one side of my wall, then those entangled degrees of freedom are no longer in a pure state taken by themselves. They become in a mixed state. And that mixed state has a thermal character. A thermal state is a state with some randomness in it, right? As opposed to being a pure state, which is a definite state.
Now, it's important here that this wall is not a physical wall. It's right. An artifact of your coordinates or what?
Yeah, an artifact of my choice to carve up space into two halves.
So then, like, to the layperson who's listening or watching, does that mean that they think of carving up space in a certain way? They just imagine it, and then all of a sudden they see a thermal bath? Because that doesn't seem right.
It's right. If they restrict their... Yeah, right. So if they restrict their observations, it's causality is another key element here. So once again, here's our wedge. If I restrict observations to this part of space-time, I can't be influenced by something on the other side of this horizon. So I could just choose to leave, cross the horizon. But if I don't, and I just restrict attention to observables in this wedge, then they are described by a thermal state. So it has to do with restricting attention to a subset of all the possible observables. Let me give you another simple example that's often brought up to explain the key idea of entanglement, which is a spin state of two spins that's a singlet state. It's a completely rotationally invariant state of two spin one-half degrees of freedom.
Uh-huh.
And they're opposite to each other completely in the singlet state. But which direction each one of them is in by itself is completely indeterminate. And if I can only observe this spin, and I measure it, I'll find it completely random what direction its spin is. And if I measure only this spin, I'll find it completely random what direction it is. But if I measure both of them, or if somebody else measures, we'll find that they're always exactly opposite to each other. So if we measure along the same axis. So they're correlated in an inextricable way in a pure state. But when we restrict attention to one of them, that has a random state. That's a good analogy.
So let's say one is spin up, then if you measure, let's say you measure it and one is spin up, then it must be that the other is spin down. Okay, now for the virtual particle pairs, what property is it that's entangled? Like what you just gave was the spin property is entangled.
Oh, that's a great question. It's the occupation number of the mode. Okay, I have to explain. Can I explain that?
Sure.
Let's see. So, right. So in quantum field theory, we can break up all the field. The field is a function of space, so it's a continuous function, right? But we can decompose it into modes, which are like waves of a definite wavelength, let's say. Okay? But in quantum mechanics, each mode is like a harmonic oscillator. It's a quantum system which can be in its ground state, first excited state, second, third, fourth, etc. And in this thermal state, what we find is that there's a certain probability of it being in each level. The probability goes down as the level goes up, in a way determined by the temperature. But on the other side of my imaginary wall that we just carved space into two halves of, I have a partner oscillator mode.
Uh-huh.
Okay, now this one by itself could be in any one of its levels. This could be in any one of its levels. But there's a correlation between which level this is in and which level this is in. And that's the nature of the entanglement.
Now, in that case, it wouldn't be an anti-correlation because then you'd have negative energy?
Yeah, let's see. It is an anti-correlation in terms of a globally defined boost Hamiltonian. Yeah.
So what would it mean then? Let's say you're in your first excited state outside the area. If there's the ground state, what's lower than the ground state?
Yeah, it can't be below it. Yeah, no, I think that's... the question is, are you taking the time flow to be up on both sides of the wall, okay, or up on one side and down on the other side? So because we take it down on one side, we count this as negative energy, but it's actually locally measured as positive. So
this is that Wheeler interpretation that it's an antiparticle? Like when you go backward in time, then it's an antiparticle?
Yeah, I would say it's related to that because it's the thing that, like say we're talking about an electron-positron field. The thing an electron here is correlated to across the other side of the horizon is a positron. So, and if you think of a positron as an electron going backwards in time, then it's correlated to an electron going backwards in time. But I think that's a confusing perspective to try to take.
So let's see if I got this correct. Quantum fields are constantly popping in and out of existence, these pairs, these particle-antiparticle pairs in this example. Now, these pairs are entangled, as you mentioned, and you can imagine a boundary where the pair is straddling it. And so you have one partner on each side.
Correct.
And if you only observe one side, then you've lost information about the other partner.
Exactly.
Now, it makes it appear random and thermal, like it has temperature. And
correct,
this lost information, entropy, depends on the boundary area. We haven't gotten to that point, but
yeah, right.
I've gone through your work, so I'm summarizing a bit further. But why don't you get to the boundary area now?
Right. So how much, that has to do with how much entanglement there is, and what does that have to do with entropy? So going back to the example of just the two spins, one half, which is the simplest example we can construct in quantum mechanics. How much entropy is there in this singlet state, this perfectly correlated state that looks totally random when you restrict to one of them? It's exactly one bit of entropy. This is an information theoretic interpretation of entropy. So logarithm of two, because there are two alternatives and they're both equally probable. So if you want to know, well, how much entropy is there associated with this quantum field randomness that we just described? So every mode of the field has some amount of entropy associated with it. But there are an infinite number of modes of the field, and they're packed into the infinite, like the divergence in the density of modes that we have to count up if we're trying to account for all of this entanglement entropy, it's called, is packed up very close to the corner of that wedge, or right up next to the horizon. In the context of a black hole, that has to do with the infinite redshift at the horizon of the black hole. But in standard quantum field theory, there's no shortest wavelength of modes. The field can fluctuate on any scale, no matter how small. And that's required by Lorentz symmetry, as far as we know, by relativistic symmetry. So because there's an infinite number of them, it looks like there's an infinite entanglement entropy. Infinite.
Mm-hmm.
That is like a problem if you're thinking the entanglement entropy has something to do with the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy, because the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy is finite. It's the area divided by 4 times the Planck length squared. So that's finite. But the idea physically is that, okay, we're missing some physics. If we just try to use quantum field theory to count up this entropy and ignore gravity when we're doing the counting, we're going to get infinity, which is the wrong answer. If we take into account the effect of gravity, how is that going to change the story I just told? Well, remember, you just mentioned the energy of these fluctuations. That's crucial. So the ones that are leading to the infinite entropy have higher and higher and higher energy because they're localized at smaller and smaller and smaller distances from each other and from the horizon. And according to quantum mechanics, if you localize something smaller and smaller, it has a bigger and bigger uncertainty in its energy. Now, if we turn on gravity, we take into account the fact that everything is affected by gravity. That energy is a source of gravity, and gravity causes the space-time to be curved. So the picture I was just using for counting up the entropy initially was just a nice smooth space-time. We plunked our quantum fields into it, and they're doing their fluctuating virtual thing.
Mm-hmm.
But now we have to take into account, if you're going down to the shortest distance scale, you better take into account that gravity is acting very strongly at that scale on these fluctuations. And you can actually anticipate that once the fluctuation and its partner get so close together that the gravitational fluctuation they create engulfs them both in like a miniature horizon, then it's not any more possible to separate them.
Uh-huh.
So this picture of the imaginary wall that I described initially, at the very shortest scale, it becomes fuzzy in a way that we can't control, like who's on which side of the wall. It just becomes meaningless. So it has to cut itself off because of gravity. And the place it cuts itself off is, you can argue in a hand-waving way, is at the right scale to match the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy.
New update. Started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.